Well, friends, welcome. So we'll be learning the topic directors, and there are various aspects to it. Let us say first we'll understand what is the meaning of director, who are the directors. Then we'll be understanding what is their responsibility, how they are appointed. All these things we are supposed to know. How meetings are conducted, board meetings are conducted. That also we are supposed to know. First, let us try to understand what is the meaning of director, how it is defined. And you know, the group of directors are called as the board of directors. In every company, we find there is a board, popularly called as board, but that means board of directors. And the members of the board of directors are called as directors. And we'll be also knowing there are various types of directors up there, like executive director, non-executive director. Okay, there might be independent directors. So like this, so we'll be looking at those aspects also. Let me share the screen with you right now. Now, friends, when we first try to understand the meaning of directors, first, let us see this section 2, clause 10, which talks about what is board, and the member of the board will be called as board of directors. Now, if you read this thing, it says board of directors, or simply board, in relation to company, means the collective body of directors of the company. That means the collective body of the directors will be called as board of directors, or simply you can refer to as board. When I'm saying board, that means I'm referring to board of directors. So this in fact is the collective body of directors. Therefore, to understand the term board, first of all, I need to understand what is the meaning of directors. And to understand that thing, what is the meaning of directors, I have to refer to section 2, clause 32. If you read, here it is defined. Will you read it? What is that? Section 2, clause 34. Director means, can any of you read it? Please unmute.
Director means a director appointed to the board of a company.
Okay. That means if someone is appointed as a director to the board of the company, he'll be reported as director. Okay, so appointment should be made as director. So that is the definition. So director means a director appointed to the board of the company. Okay, and board means the collective body of directors. So this is the very simple definition, which is there in section 2, clause 34. So this gives us an understanding that, first of all, we need to know that only individuals can be appointed as director. You cannot appoint a body corporate as director. You cannot appoint a partnership firm as a director. Right. So those individuals who are appointed to manage the business of the company, manage the affairs of the company, you can report to the directors. And all of us know that company is an artificial person. We know that it is created by law. It has got separate legal existence. So all these things are there. So company can behave just like a person. It can hold property. It can acquire property. It can dispose of property. It can do many things. It can do its business. But company doesn't have any physical body or mind. So how can it take this? So human beings are needed to manage the companies. So these human beings can be referred to as directors who manages the company. Okay, so company needs to be managed by a group of people who are called as board of directors. There needs to be, you can say company needs to be directed by these people because they have their body and mind, they can give direction. If you see practically, if I ask you who are the owners of the company, directors are not the owners of the company, not necessarily. The real owners of the company are the shareholders. Okay, they are owners of the company. So if they are owners of the company, then it may come to your mind, then it is the shareholders who should manage the company because they are the owners, it is their company. But please appreciate that in a large size company, imagine the number of shareholders. Voluminous. Okay, size is very big. So if all of them come together and manage the company, they will not be able to manage the company. Rather, there is a possibility that company will be mismanaged. Because the number of shareholders are many. Therefore, company is managed by directors. Okay, and most of the cases, these are the directors who are elected by shareholders. Or sometimes, there may be directors who come from outside. They might be outsiders also. So in fact, these are the people who manage the company. Okay, who are the owners of the company? Shareholders. But who manages the company? Board of directors. Okay, after this, is it clear to you? And who can be director? He has to be an individual. Yeah, any query you have? Is it clear or you have any doubt?
No, sir, it's clear, sir.
Okay, thank you. Now,
sir?
Yeah, please ask your query.
Sir, any shareholder treated as a director?
If shareholder is appointed to the board of directors as director, then only he will be a director. But he's not appointed as a director, he cannot be a director.
Okay.
Sir, he can be elected also?
Yeah, definitely he can be elected, he can become a director. Shareholders can become a director, but that doesn't mean that all the directors are shareholders. And it is also not necessary to become director, you have to hold some shares. That is also not necessary. Shareholders can be completely different, directors can be completely different set of persons. Okay. That possibility is also there.
Yes, sir.
Right? Shareholders can become director, and director need not hold a single share also. Okay, friends. Now, let us try to understand now what is the legal position of the director. Now you have understood who can be appointed as the directors, who are the directors. And if you look at the legal position of the directors, they are in fact, they play a dual role. They are both agents and trustees. Why they are called as the agents? Because as agent, they represent the company. They can bind the company by their decisions, by their actions. If they do something, that means it will be taken as if company has done that. So by their actions, they can bind the company. Okay, so company is the principal and they are the agent. Okay, so the law of agency comes into play and it governs the relationship between the company and director. So you say, what is the relationship between a company and director? Same as principal and agent. Company is the principal, director is the agent. Okay, so one position is that they are just like agents of the company. And as we are discussing, they play a dual position also. They play a dual role. They also play the role of a trustee. Okay, trustee in the sense the directors are required or they are expected to take care of the properties, money, trade secrets, etc. Right, that bunch of trust they should give. So they also act as the trustees of the company. So they are trustees as well as their agents. Okay. In fact, directors are in a fiduciary relationship. That means the relationship of trust with the company. And the office of directorship is an office of trust. And if you look at the definition of officer, earlier we have also studied what is the meaning of officer when we are learning the topic KMP, key managerial personnel. So the definition of officer is given in section 2, clause 59. And if you look at that, it says officer includes a director. Have remembered, we have already studied that. So officer includes a director. That means if someone is asking whether director is an officer of the company or what do you say? Yes or no? Is director?
Yes.
Yes, he's an officer of the company. Director is, of course, is an officer of the company. And for certain provisions of the law, directors are also treated as employee. Since they're officers and officers are the employee of the company. Okay. So for application of some of the provisions of Companies Act, they are also treated as employee. Okay. But that is not always true. That employer-employee relationship may be there, may not be there. But for application of certain provisions, they'll be treated as employee, as directors are officers and officers are employees. Is it clear to you about the position of the director? Legal position of the director? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, just now we are discussing that the collective body of the directors is called as board or board of directors. It is the board which takes decision at its meetings. That means how decision can be taken? Decision can be taken at the meetings, not by individual director. Okay, individual director can do some activity, but decision are taken at the meeting, at the board. Okay, so for example, individual director may sign a check that may be honored by a bank, but decision should have been taken in a meeting that this person, this director is authorized to operate the bank account. So decision has to be taken in a meeting. Are you getting? And companies are managed through these decisions. And that is the reason for which there is a concept of quorum. Have you heard of this word quorum? You can see the screen, it is written quorum. Have you heard of this word before? Or you are listening for the first time?
No, sir.
Okay. So what is the quorum? Quorum means presence of minimum number of members. So many cases you can find in board meeting, in general meeting also. Other meetings also you can find out many meetings. First of all, but there is a requirement that we can conduct the meeting only when these many members are present. Suppose one third member should be present, then only you can start meeting. Or minimum five members should be there, then only you can start meeting. That requirement of minimum number of members in a meeting is called as quorum. Since decisions are taken in the board meeting, so there is a requirement of quorum. Only when one cannot say that, you see, I hold meeting with only one person. That means you yourself has taken a meeting. Quorum was not there. So that will not happen. So it should be since decisions are required to be taken in the meeting, so the quorum aspect needs to be taken care of. Are you getting me?
Yes, sir.
When I say quorum, that means the presence of minimum number of directors at a board meeting is prescribed. We'll be learning that thing when we'll be learning about the board meetings. Meeting is, I think, perhaps our next chapter. So at that time, we'll be understanding what is the requirement of quorum and for different kind of meetings, how quorums are decided, how quorums are counted, all these things will be seen. Right. But sometimes it is permitted that decisions can be taken by the board without calling a meeting. But in that too, that can be collective decisions. That also has to be collective decisions, but decisions can be taken without calling meeting. That means you can circulate the resolution, you can circulate that decision, which if it's approved by members, then it is accepted. But that's again a collective decision. Decisions are taken collectively, but without meeting. Are you getting? That is also possible. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, friends, now let us learn this, having understood that what are the basic things, who are the directors, how decisions are taken in a company. Now, let us learn this section 149, which provides that company to have board of directors. That means if you want to run a company, you should have a board of directors. Now, this provision, several subsections are there. We'll be learning one by one. First of all, 149.1, it says, every company shall have a board of directors consisting of individuals as directors. So here also, this section itself makes it very clear that who can become directors? Who can become directors? Can a company become director of another company? Yes or no? Question is, can a company become director of another company?
Company cannot be, sir.
Company cannot be. Okay. Why? Because you see, the provision of 149.1 says consisting of individuals as directors. So only individuals can be directors. Okay. That individual may be representing some other company. That possibility is also there. Sometimes one company is represented by another, by an individual. That also may happen. Sometimes bankers and financial institutes, when they give finance, they give a condition that one of the board members should be from our company. But that doesn't mean the company is the director. So one of their employee may be representing the bank. That possibility is also. Okay, but director has to be an individual. Okay, are you getting
me?
Okay. Now, so that is why a person other than individuals like body corporate, firm, association, they cannot be appointed as director. Now, next concept is that we have also studied this provision, that what is the minimum number of directors for different kind of company. So as you can see in the bottom portion of your screen, that you can say in public company, what is the minimum directors required to have? Who can tell me?
Three.
A private company?
Private company, two, sir.
Two. And in case of an OPC, one person company?
One, sir?
Yeah, one. You see, this is a minimum requirement. Okay, you can keep directors more than that. Again, please try to appreciate, this is a minimum requirement. Even an OPC can have more than one director. Okay, OPC means one member. But there can be more than one director. Director can be more than one, but member is one. Okay, this is the minimum requirement of a director for a public company. Three, private company, two, and for OPC, it's one. Is it clear or you have any doubt? Okay, good. Now, friends, now you might be thinking, if that is minimum, then what is the maximum number of directors? Friends, in fact, there is no maximum limit. One can give any number of directors. But law has prescribed that if you want to keep a board with more than 15 directors, up to 15 directors is okay, then you can do so after passing a special resolution. That means practically there is no restriction. You can keep, if you want to keep 20 directors, you can keep it. But what you have to do? You have to pass a special resolution for that. What is special resolution? What is ordinary resolution? We have discussed earlier. Have you remembered? Special resolution is a kind of resolution. First of all, where notice must have been served that this resolution is going to be passed as a special resolution. That means it should have been communicated. Second thing is that in that resolution, vote cast in favor of the resolution must be at least three times of the votes cast against it. Okay. That means at least the resolution should have been passed by 3/4 majority. Votes which are cast in favor of the resolution must be at least three times more than the vote cast against the resolution, if any. So that is called a special resolution. First notice must have been given as indicating that special resolution is going to be passed. Second, this condition, 3/4. So if you want, or if some a company wants to have a board with more than 15 directors, then what it can do? It has to pass a special resolution. That's it. So that doesn't mean that you cannot have a director with more than 15 directors. 15, up to 15, okay. You can simply appoint directors by ordinary resolution. But if it is more than 15, you need special resolution. Okay. Is it clear to you?
Yes.
Okay, but there are certain exceptions. Now we'll be learning those exceptional parts. Okay. Now, okay, before going to exceptions, let us have a look at this chart. What we have learned, this chart summarizes that thing. Minimum director for a public company is three, for a private company is two, for a one-person company is one, and maximum number of directors is 15. More directors can be appointed by passing a special resolution. That is what we have learned so far. Now let us move to exemptions, or you can say these are few exceptions. First of all, you see what is written here, a government company. We already know what is a government company. initial classes when we are learning various types of the companies, we know what is a government company too. What you can revise those videos are available. Now you see, government companies exempted from application of section 149(1)(b), which requires companies to have maximum 15 directors only. That a government company need not have maximum 15 directors. It can go beyond that also because they are exempted for application of that particular section. So in a government company, without special resolution also, one can have more than 15 directors. Second, government companies are also exempted from application of proviso to section 149(1), which enables the company to appoint more than 15 directors after passing a special resolution. So they are also exempted for this. So they need not pass special resolution. And they can also give directors more than 15. Okay, understood? Exemption to the government company. Is it clear to you?
Yes.
But again, there is a condition. You see, condition, if you read the bottom part of your screen, you can see, however, the above exemption is applicable only if such government company has not committed a default in filing its financial statements or annual return with registrar. That means the government company should not have made any default in finding its financial statements. So you must be knowing that every company on an annual basis requires to submit its financial statement, that is balance sheet, statement of profit and loss, cash flow, etc. All these things need to be submitted to ROC. And also it has to file an annual return containing various information that also needs to be filed. The financial statements are required to be filed under section 137 and the annual returns are required to be filed under section 92. And this has to be filed with the registrar of companies or with the ROC. Electronically they are filed. Okay. In fact, there are specified forms. That forms need to be filled up electronically. And these documents, the financial statements, etc., needs to be attached to that form and that is submitted as on payment of certain fee. Fees are also paid. And this is an annual compliance requirement. Every year you have to do it if you are having a company. Okay, so this aspect needs to be taken care of. Annual accounts need to be, annual financial statement needs to be prepared, audited, and also uploaded with ROC. And if the company, if a government company has committed any default, that he cannot avail this exemption. The exemption is allowed only when the government company has not committed any default in filing annual return and filing of financial statements. Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Understood this thing? Right. Fine. Now, there is one more exception. One more exemption. Let us see that. As you can see, one more exemption. And this time, exemption is not to government company, but to which company? Can you read it here?
Section 8 company.
Have you remembered what is this? What are these?
Yes, sir. These are all coming under charitable trust,
yes,
sports,
exactly. In fact, charitable companies which cannot distribute their profit by way of dividends, right? So these company can avail this benefit. That means they can also appoint more than 15 directors. Okay, and this special resolution requirement also doesn't apply to them, but again, provided they have not committed any default in filing the financial statements or annual returns to the registrar. If that default is committed, then this exemption is gone. If they have not committed, fine. Understood this? Exemption.
Yes, sir. Okay. Sir, mean the restriction is same for this Section 8 company and the government company also.
The restriction is same.
Right.
Yes, right. Okay. Understood now what is the basic idea that how many directors should be there, what is the minimum requirement, what is the max requirement, and what are the exceptions to that. Now we have understood that. Now, another interesting requirement, let us see. Useful requirement also. That's the requirement of open directors. So here requirement is that at least one woman director shall be on the board of such class or classes of the company as has been prescribed in Rule 3 of Companies Appointment and Qualification of Directors Rule 2004. So that means there is a rule, and Rule 3 prescribes that at least one woman director needs to be appointed in the board. Now you might be wondering that who are the companies who are supposed to appoint at least one woman director. Let us have a look. Now you see. Are you able to read it? First of all, every listed company. You know who are the listed company. Listed company means their securities are listed in a recognized stock exchange. Okay, that also we have understood earlier about listed company. And every other public company having paid up capital of 100 crore rupees or more, if paid up capital is 100 crore rupees or more, or turnover of 300 crore of rupees or more. So paid up capital is 100 crore or more, or turnover is 300 crore or more, and it should be a public company. That company also should have one woman member in its board of directors. So every listed company needs to have it, and public company where paid up capital is 100 crore or more, or turnover is 300 crore or more, need to have a woman director. Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Now you might be thinking that how to check the paid up capital and turnover. You need to refer to the last. You have to see the turnover or paid up capital as on the last date of the latest audited financial statement. So by referring to the previous latest audited financial statement, we have to decide whether there is a requirement to appoint at least one woman director in the board. In case it's a newly incorporated company, that means company which has incorporated recently, and in case this requirement applies to it, that the requirement of appointment of woman director applies to it, then that company shall comply with the provisions within a period of 6 months from the date of incorporation. Okay, suppose newly listed companies incorporated. So within 6 months, it has to appoint a woman director. Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
And in case intermittent vacancies are there. Okay, intermittent vacancies means suppose woman director resigned or some other reason that woman director's office is vacant. Then that can be filled off by board at the earliest, as soon as possible that needs to be filled up, but not later than immediate next board meeting or 3 months from the date of such vacancy, whichever is later. That means maximum within 3 months you have to fill up that vacancy if there is any intermittent vacancies. Okay, not later than immediate next board meeting or 3 months from the date of such vacancy. That position needs to be filled up. Are you getting me? Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Now, yes, sir. Understood. Now, women director concept we have understood. Now, one more concept which I'll be learning. This is about resident director. It says that every company shall have at least one director who stays in India for a total period of not less than 182 days during the financial year. So if you pick up a financial year, there should be at least one director who must have stayed in India for how many days? 182 days. 182 days means approximately half of a year. So at least for nearly for 6 months, he should have stayed in India. We'll be referring to that director as a resident director. Okay, 182 days test we have to do. But however, in case of a newly incorporated company, suppose the company is just newly incorporated, then what we'll do? We have to apply this particular rule or this particular section proportionately. Proportionately means, suppose company is incorporated, company previous year, it was only for 1 month. then it is not 180 days. Test is 182 divided by 12 because company is incorporated for 1 month and proportionately will apply this. Okay, this particular section needs to be applied proportionately. Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, resident director, you have understood. Now, friends, one more concept that is about independent director. So, this is with a view to improve corporate governance, these provisions are introduced. This provision is prescribed to large public companies, and other large companies also are required to have independent director in their board. Okay. An independent director needs to have an independent mindset. That means he should not be unduly influenced by the other members of the board. He should be really truly independent. He should have an independent mindset, should not be influenced by other board members. Okay, and in case the other board members take any illegal decision, any wrong decision, or a decision which is not in the best interest of the company, or which is not in the best interest of the country's economy, okay, then the independent director may raise objection. Okay, in those kind of situations, this decision must be hindered by the independent directors. They must raise an objection. Okay, they will create hindrances, so they will object to that. That is how that you can ensure better corporate governance. Are you getting it? What is the primary role of independent director? I think you have understood. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, friends, one more concept. Interested director. What is coming to your mind if I say interested director? What do you think? Interested director.
Interested to work as a director, sir.
He's interested to become director, right? That is what coming to your mind. You see, everybody is interested to be the directors, otherwise, because that's why we'll be learning further also. That they must have given consent that they agreed to become directors. So they're interested. And they're interested in the board meeting also. They're interested with the comp. So there is nothing called as you can say disinterested directors. But here, when you talk about interested directors, here what we mean that when they have some interest with a particular transaction or with a particular decision, in that case, we'll refer to that director as a interested director. Suppose you are a member of a board of directors, board member of a company, and company is discussing to award a contract to a company. Okay, and suppose you are in the board of directors of company A, and company is planning, company is in the process of taking a decision to award a contract to a company B. You are in A, but award will be to company B. And you have some interest in company B. Company B may be your client, company B may be a company in which you are also director, company B might be your relative's company. So, in that case, you are treated as an interested director. In that case, what is expected that when the decision is going on, the discussion is going on for decision, you are supposed to disclose your interest. Okay, that is the requirement. Are you getting me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that case, that director will be referred as interested director. So let us learn what is the meaning of that. Let me share the screen again. So, interested director is he's one director among other members of the board. But in fact, an existing director becomes interested in a transaction of the company. He is called interested director. That means if he is interested in a transaction, he'll be called as interested director. And he needs to disclose his interest at appropriate forum and at appropriate time. At appropriate time, he's supposed to disclose his interest. Your appropriate time is as soon as possible. He needs to disclose. Not that decision has already been taken, after that he's disclosed. That should not have happened. That is not the appropriate time. So before discussion is taking place, before everybody is participating in the discussion, he should discuss that he is an interested director. He has some interest with the transaction. Okay. Now, friends, two more terms we are going to learn. One is executive director, second is non-executive director. In fact, a board of directors may comprise both executive directors and directors and non-executive directors. When you say executive director, they are in fact responsible for managing different business operations undertaken by the company. Maybe they're looking after some specific business operations, maybe director of finance, director of production, maybe something like this. They're looking after specific business operations. It is their responsibility that departments which they head operate smoothly. Suppose the responsibility of the director personnel is to ensure that the personnel department, HR department, is functioning properly. The responsibility of the director of finance is to ensure that the finance department is running properly. But when I say non-executive director, they participate through board meetings in discussion relating to forming the policies of the efficient management of the company. So non-executive directors, they participate in board discussions, in board meetings. Okay, they do not head any department. Understood? And when I say independent directors, which you have learned sometime before, independent directors are non-executive directors. So they participate in the board meeting. They do not head any particular department. Okay, they are not responsible for managing different business operations. Okay, and here you have to remember this non-executive directors, independent directors and non-executive directors. Okay, they are not as active as executive directors. Executive directors are more active because they have to look after the business operations. And executive directors are to be held liable if they knowingly consented to the wrongful acts if the company has taken some wrongful acts, just like directors, they'll be held responsible for that. Okay, this is about executive directors and non-executive directors. Friends, these are various kinds of directors we have learned so far. Next concept is about the appointment of directors. It is in fact a different process. We'll be learning it separately in a different session. So after this, we have learned basic things about directors. Who can be appointed as directors? What is the maximum number of directors? What is the minimum number of directors? And also various other kinds of directors we have learned. If you have any query, then ask me freely. You have any query on this?
No, sir. No. Clear.
Up to this, it is very clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so thank you very, very much.